these topics about diversity and difference can be sometimes a little vulnerable, or as we said in our table, uncomfortable, but discomfort is not always a bad thing, so thank you. Welcome to the luncheon portion of our program for the day. We're in for a treat. We're going to be talking about different abilities or unique skills that different people have that aren't always obvious. All right, we're good? We're going to have a short prayer. Shall we pray? God the Creator, thank you for making each one of us. Thank you for knitting each one of us together in our mother's wombs. We are grateful that each day ordained for us was known to you before the beginning of time. We're grateful that our unique sets of abilities are a reflection of your creative beauty. We're grateful that we are created to fulfill a purpose. May we all, each one, recognize that exquisite uniqueness and seek to use that for the common good. Amen. Enjoy your lunch. I'm going to have my two friends here, Courtney, who works with Mindshift, and Leanne, who works for herself and sometimes works at Concordia, introduce our speakers to us.
So I'm Courtney Jensen, and I have the pleasure of working with Mindshift. I will let Tim talk about Mindshift, and I'm just going to talk about Tim for a moment. The only thing I'll say about Mindshift is we work with people on the autism spectrum. And I have a son who's on the autism spectrum, and so when I came to work with Mindshift, I had heard that the founder and board chair, Tim Hansen, also had a son with autism. And I assumed that the reason he wanted to see people with autism work was to create a space for his son to have a job. And when I first met Tim, I found out that his son is actually not in the category of people who would most likely fit with what we do with Mindshift. And I was really touched by that, because what I realized is that Tim wanted to create a world where people with autism are valued not because of his own personal experience, but because he really truly sees the value of these people. And that touched me. And as I got to know Tim, I realized that that is exactly who Tim is. Tim sees the value of the people that he's around, and that is just absolutely pervasive in his life. He is an amazing man, and he's a man who, if he says he's gonna do something for you, he does it. If he says he's going to pray for you, he does it. And his belief and his faith marches out in everything he does. And I am honored to be associated with him. I'm honored to work for him. And he's someone who, when he speaks, I listen, and I invite you to do the same. So, Tim Hansen.
My name is Leanne Wolf, and I have had the privilege of meeting Carrie Buchholz probably 2 years ago. I was working with a client, More Engineering, and Kevin Buchholz recommended I meet Carrie and learn the story of Haley's Hope. When you get to know Carrie, there are a couple of things that stand out. One of those is that this is a woman of determination and passion and a deep love of family. Do not get between her and her kids. That is the moral of the story for the instructors. And she came to found Haley's Hope because her little guy has dyslexia. And she wanted him to have the best opportunities in life. And if she couldn't find those opportunities within the current system, she was going to change it. And so that's what she did. She's changing the conversation about dyslexia because she believes so deeply in learning success. So, Carrie Buchholz.
I really didn't think I came off as that much of a bear between me and my kids, but I probably kind of am. Okay, let me see if I can get this to work. Yay. Okay, well, that's who I am. All right, so first of all, thank you for letting me share how dyslexia entered my life and talk to you a little bit about why I'm here or how I got here to be in the position to even talk with you about it today. So in 2005, like I did about 4 years earlier, when I took my daughter to school on her first day, this fall of 2005, I was able to take my son, Haley. And he was this happy, outgoing, talkative little boy, and was excited to go to school and meet not only new kids, new friends, but meet new adults and his teachers. And I, like every other parent, thought this is going to be a journey of exploration and fun and learning for him. But not far into that preschool year, about October, my husband and I were being told that he wasn't keeping up with the rest of the kids in his class. And I wasn't prepared for that. I didn't know what that meant. And for the next 2.5 years, I found myself trying to figure out why our son Haley was not learning like our daughter Summer, why he was not learning like the rest of the kids in his class. By the time he was 6, he still did not know what a letter was. He couldn't identify a letter. He didn't know what the sound of a letter was. And he didn't understand if he put two of those little letters together, an M and an E, per se, that it created a word. And you could read that word and it said me. And so by the first week of first grade, I had lost so much of that happy little boy I sent to school to fear, anxiety, him crying, mom crying, frustration, and lack of self-esteem because he was such a failure, that I knew I had to try and get this little boy back because I knew there was more to him. So during that 2.5 years, I found myself practically begging others to help me figure out what was going on. And in the end, I realized that I'm going to have to try and figure this out on my own because I couldn't find anybody to help. And I did. And the answer to his struggles was and is dyslexia. Our son Haley is profoundly dyslexic. Those high expectations that we as parents, or that me as a parent, put on our kids when we send them to preschool or to first grade or to kindergarten, is quickly erased if somebody has dyslexia. No matter how hard they try, no matter how hard we as parents try and make them learn, as my son used to say, Mom, I'm not book smart, I'm street smart. Because those little things that most of us take for granted and that our kids learn automatically, reading and writing, no matter how hard we try and push them to do it, they just aren't able to connect with that. And so I want you to think about what you guys did this morning. Who picked up the paper to read the paper? Who opened an email? Who typed an email? Who sent a text? Who maybe took their phone and dialed a number? Who maybe picked up the remote control for your TV and put your TV channel on 6 or 467? If you don't know what those letters and numbers are that you're looking at, those simple tasks are impossible to do. So about 10 years ago, over 10 years ago, I took my first training regarding dyslexia in California. And after that first long day of learning information, it was a week and a half long course, I went back to my room crying, and I called my husband, Kevin, and I said, we need to help others. This journey had been so hard already, but I had just learned that there's 1 in 5 children and adults that have dyslexia. And so, of course, my goal was to help our son, Haley, because I needed to get him out of this funk that he was in. But I also couldn't take myself, if I went back or came back to Fargo, and knew that there were 1 in 5 kids and families out there that were hitting the wall like I did because there was no resources in this community to understand what that D word was, what dyslexia was. Because it doesn't just affect reading and writing, it truly affects the hearts and souls of our kids as they enter school. So about 2 years after that visit in California, we had a name, and we called it Haley's Hope. Because I knew I needed to teach other kids the way I was teaching Haley, because I got my son back. We got our son back. But I didn't know what to do with that. I'm like, okay, now I have a name. What do I do? I was already owner of another business. So all of my time and energies were with that and with my family. But one day, the business across the hall from where I was at decided that they need to relocate, and my landlord came to me and said, you have first dibs on this space. And I thought, oh my gosh, there's my opportunity. It can be right across the hall. All I have to do is walk over there, spend a little bit of time over there, put my other hat on, and go back to my other business. And I thought, this is it. And the more I thought about it, I got scared. I got scared of the financial responsibility, and I got scared of the time that I was going to have to spend, because if I was going to do it, I needed to do it right. So I called my landlord one morning, and I said, you know, thank you, but I can't take that space. And he said, okay. I said, open it up to somebody else. And that afternoon, my husband and I went to the bank, because we had to do some banking things, and we sat in the room as some paperwork was being done, and as we were chatting with the gal that was next to us, we talked about family, as we do as parents and our kids, and I started to talk about Haley and, you know, his struggles, and she said, I read to my daughter all through elementary school, all through middle school, all through high school so she could graduate. I read my daughter all of her textbooks in college so she could graduate. My daughter is dyslexic, but I didn't have any help. And I sat there thinking, okay. You know, 2.5 years ago, somebody was knocking on my heart going, what are you going to do? And I went back to the office, and I picked up the phone, and I called my landlord and said, I hope you haven't rented that yet, or, you know, told somebody else I could have it because I need to take it. Finally, somebody got to my heart and got to my soul and said, you need to take this leap of faith. You need to take that room across the hall and try to do it. So I called him up and said, I'm going to take that space. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know how I'm going to pay you, but I need to take it. And so oftentimes when I talk about, let's see if, oh, it might work. Oftentimes when I do presentations, I talk about the difficulties of dyslexia and what it does to our kids. But we also have to remember there are great gifts that come with dyslexia. And this particular video I found really has both of them in there. It talks about the beginning, what unknown dyslexia does to somebody, and it talks about the end, what those great gifts are. So I want you to just watch this little video. If it'll come up, I think it will. Thank you. So there we go. Really, dyslexia is real. It's not the D word. It's not just a learning and reading disability. It's called dyslexia. And as I've learned through Leanne, wherever she is, to try and express what we do, our mission is that learning success changes lives, because we have to understand how people learn in order to give them the ability to allow them to be successful, right? So, little thing, anybody here at Giving Hearts Day yesterday? Anybody here? Okay. So, great event, obviously. Incredible what those foundations do together. But there was one little thing that stuck out to me. Somebody got up to this microphone and was talking, and they were announcing something that was in a brochure. And they said, I'm not going to read this all to you because I know every one of you can read yourself. And she put it down. And I thought, big assumption. Because not only kids are dyslexic, adults are dyslexic. They grow up and they become adults. And if you can't read as a kid, you still can't read as an adult or write. So Haley's Hope is here today because of Haley. Because there was more to Haley than we were seeing in preschool, kindergarten, and first grade. And Haley now is that big face on the left of your screen. He's 16 years old, he's a sophomore in high school, and he has challenges every single day. Some days he doesn't know what day it is. He doesn't know what time it is. He doesn't know, well, he knows how to get home now, but he doesn't know how to traverse through our streets. But he is successful, and he's confident, and he's a great advocate for himself. So I thank you for listening to my story. I could talk all day, but I'm not gonna. All right, thank you.
That was terrific. Thank you for the opportunity to talk today. I want to especially give thanks to Concordia. I know this sounds hokey, but it really does feel like coming home when I come to Concordia, in part because starting in 1974 when I was in fourth grade, at least one of my siblings was a student at Concordia until I graduated in 1986. So actually, in 1977, there were three of my siblings at Concordia at the same time. And since my dad was a Lutheran pastor up in Crookston, we had so much money to pay for it that it was super easy. And my grandma lived two blocks north of Park Region on Fifth Avenue and was a huge Concordia supporter. So it really is like coming home. And I grew up in Crookston, right up the road. That's the right side of the tracks for you people in Moorhead, Crookston. I'm here to talk about MindShift, and so I'll talk a little bit about who we are, what we do, get into the process a little bit, and then if you want to ask questions, that's great. MindShift, it's kind of an interesting name, and our logo historically has been a dandelion. So why would we have the dandelion as our logo? Well, when you're a kid, how many of you picked bouquets of dandelions for your mom, right? How many of you rubbed them on your cheeks because it made your cheeks yellow? Okay, yeah, dandelions were cool. But then at some point along the way, they become a pest. In fact, the Scotts company sells literally billions of dollars a year of fertilizer and herbicide to kill what? Dandelions. If your neighbor has dandelions in your yard, in their yard, and you don't have them in your yard, you kind of scowl at them because when they bloom, then they blow on your yard, and you got to go back out. So, what happened there? When you're a kid, they're really neat, and then when you get older, all of a sudden they're not so good. And yet, did you know that there are farmers who cultivate and harvest dandelions? Do you know that the dandelion leaf has more nutrients than spinach? People make wine and beer and tea out of dandelions. People actually make a living growing dandelions. So is it an herb or is it a pest? Still a dandelion, right? It's all in our perception of what it is, right? Well, as Courtney so eloquently said, we employ people on the autism spectrum, and unless you've been sound asleep for the last 15 years, autism is in the news all the time, right? We have an epidemic of autism. I'm not sure we do, but we have a much heightened awareness of it. And generally speaking, when you say autism, the first thing that pops into people's minds is not, well, isn't that nice? Autism, that's, do your kid has autism? Good for you. That's not the perception. The perception is, well, that person's disabled. That person, if you're in the education business, how many budgets are strained from the cost of special education? It's a big expense for school districts. And a lot of that goes to autism, quite frankly. So we at MindShift are dedicated to helping people understand that there actually can be an advantage to autism. So let's see. Click. It's like a phaser deal from Star Trek.
On the autism spectrum, it's true that, for me, a routine trip to the grocery store can be fraught with blinding fluorescent lights and a stomach-turning spill on aisle 6, but it's also true that with my super ability to notice every little thing, I can tell the butcher that there's something fishy about their label on his yellowfin tuna. It's true that there's work out there that is so repetitive, so mind-numbing, that it would drive most people bonkers. But it's also true that with my incredible attention to detail, I actually thrive on finding the one needle in the haystack full of 2,453,676,282 pieces of straw. It's true that 85% of people like me in the United States can't find meaningful work because of our differences. But it's also true that I'd like nothing more than to roll up my sleeves and put some of those differences to good use. It's true that it can cost taxpayers about $6 million to take care of someone like me over the course of my lifetime. But it's also true that by supporting MindShift, a business that places and supports talent like me, you can help put a big dent in that.
You can clap if you want. That's pretty good, isn't it? Okay, so MindShift, a shift in our perception of people on the autism spectrum. And I want to be clear about this. Not everyone on the autism spectrum is a good candidate for MindShift. Courtney mentioned my son. My son is very bright, but he does have some pretty significant expressive language challenges. So at this point, probably not a good fit. The goal is that through the work of MindShift, there will be employment opportunities that open up for him as well. But our objective is to demonstrate, and we've done that, that organizations, businesses, actually can have a competitive advantage in the marketplace by employing individuals on the autism spectrum. So, we are a socially focused business. We are not a charity, although we are set up as a nonprofit. We're a socially focused business. And as a business, our job is not to cause market. And if you're familiar with cause marketing, when we first started out, I thought, gosh, if we go to businesses and say, what a great thing you'll be doing, you'll be employing people with autism. Come on board. And I got a lot of, this is a very typical Minnesota response. I didn't get any, well, that's dumb, I'm not doing that. I got a lot of smiles and, well, that's a dandy idea, Tim. You keep us informed on that. Until you bring out a contract, yeah, gosh, we'll take a look at that. Now you stay in touch. You know, that's, people call that Minnesota nice. That's actually called Minnesota passive aggressive, okay? So we're not a charity, but we are a socially focused business. Here's the issue. Lots of people being diagnosed with autism. How many people here have a child or know someone who's autistic? Yeah, okay. And that middle quote, people diagnosed with PDD-NOS, that's pervasive development disorder not otherwise specified, which for some of us with a child with autism, we used to use that a lot because we couldn't bring ourselves to say, my kid's autistic. So we'd say, well, he's PDD-NOS. Well, a lot of those folks are autistic. Even high-functioning people on the autism spectrum, they're no more likely to marry or have a job than those who are profoundly autistic. Okay, that probably shouldn't say the problem, because this isn't a problem, but for me this is personal. That's my son Joe on the left, handsome young man, he's 23. This was after we did the Minnesota or the Minneapolis bike tour last September. Joe was reading, well, let's see, he knew the alphabet and counted to 50 at 18 months, was reading signs, had a photographic memory, still does. Could not articulate to mom or dad that he wanted juice. He would take us by the hand, lead us up to the refrigerator, point. Could not articulate that. We thought, wow, we have this brilliant kid, but there's something not quite right. And I shouldn't probably say that, because it's not a matter of being right or wrong. It's different. Are any of you familiar with Temple Grandin? Temple Grandin is a PhD agriculture specialist. One of her books is Different, Not Less, I believe is the title of the book. That's a great way of putting it. Okay, so the opportunity. Anybody familiar with an employment challenge in Fargo? Is there one? Of course there is. In fact, the unemployment rate nationwide is at a very low level. And that sounds really good. But the reality is that if you have customers and you have a great product and you don't have enough people to get that product into your customers' hands, you have a productivity challenge, right? And what happens when that goes on for long periods of time is the economy slows down. So people are looking for talented, articulate, bright, hardworking, loyal people to work for them. And it's a challenge. And the fact of the matter is that there is a treasure trove of people out there who fit the bill, who are currently setting records, playing Call of Duty video games in their parents' basement. I'm not kidding, seriously. So the autism advantage. There is a Concordia graduate whose name is Steve. He lives in Fargo, graduated with a double major in music and mathematics. He has perfect pitch. Steve can calculate calculations in his head with complete accuracy. You give him a number, and he can tell you what the square root is. Now think about that. Steve has been unemployed most of his adult life because Steve's autistic. So he's quirky. And I can say that. I'm quirky. I'm not sure what normal is. I know what I know it when I see it, and it's not me. So my kid, huh?
It's a setting on the dryer.
There you go. I like that. Can I use that? I like that. But the fact of the matter is that when you're, how many people here hire for their company, do hiring? Anybody? Okay. Salespeople are easy to hire, aren't they? Because they're extroverted and they're good at articulating what their skills are and maybe minimizing what some of their challenges are. But the person that maybe isn't particularly articulate and maybe has challenges in just regular old social interaction, they tend to not get the job, which is crazy. Because guess what? A lot of times, they're the best suited for that job. So, some of the autism advantages, if you look there, what are some of the unique strengths of people on the spectrum? Accuracy. So I mentioned Steve. Steve's mom and dad, his dad's a Lutheran pastor, so he's obviously an exceptional kid. Steve and his mom, when he was 4 years old, were at a friend's house, and this friend, this woman, had just finished a Hardanger embroidery. And it was a big piece of Hardanger embroidery, which is very technical. And it was hanging on the wall, and she was showing it off, and Steve's mom was praising how beautiful it was. Steve's looking at it, and he goes, "Mama, there's a mistake." And mom was trying to get Steve to maybe quiet down and sees, Mama, there's a mistake. And in fact, there was a mistake. Well, Steve isn't going to win any popularity contest doing that, right? In fact, Steve got thrown out of math class in high school because the teacher was making mistakes and he was pointing it out, and the teacher got so offended that she threw him out of class. But Steve was right. He may not have been politically correct, he may not have been diplomatic, but Steve saw errors where others didn't see it. Steve saw patterns that other people didn't see, and then deviations in those patterns. Do you think there's value in that? Go ask Microsoft. Because when you write software code, if there's a mistake in there, there's bugs and it doesn't work. Has anyone here experienced that before? Okay, these are strengths. And by the way, things that, frankly, many people on the autism spectrum, this comes naturally for them. They're not trained this way, they're wired this way. So really, is it a disability or is it a difference? It's a rhetorical question. Okay, so when we are meeting with prospective clients, we'll find out from our clients, well, what are the tasks that you have in your organization that require attention to detail, that require perseverance, that might be repetitive, that you have a hard time staffing for? Every organization has some tasks like that. May not have a whole job like that, although sometimes they do. You heard Forrest, right, on the video. Forrest was hired by a large local accounting firm, and they had a job that they had split up among five people. So each of those five people spent 8 hours a week on that job because nobody wanted to do it all the time because it was the kind of work they didn't want to do. So we go in there, Forrest goes in there. Forrest ends up doing the job better with far fewer errors, and he does it in about 10 hours. Well, that's a great productivity boost. The trouble with that is that since we bill by the hour, we're kind of anticipating 40 hours of billable work, and we end up with 10. So we need to work on our fee structure a little bit. But anyway, we identify those challenges, and then we tailor our assessment of our candidates to fit that need. We recruit for it, and by the way, there's no lack of people to recruit from. So don't sit there and think, well, gosh, are there enough people? There's plenty of people to recruit from. We do our assessment and training, and we provide ongoing support. We have our job coaches on site, and oftentimes, the contract client will say, you know, you don't have to come anymore before we're ready to go, but they have figured out how to work with our specialists to get the most out of them. But we do provide a significant amount of support because the fact is that we want your business, our client's business, to be successful, and we want our specialists to be successful. So we'll provide the support. And identifying tasks versus roles, and this isn't a comprehensive list as we say there, but these are some of the things that our folks are really, really good at. And they're tasks that sometimes people don't want to continue to do. They'll take the job to get in the door, and then over time, I don't want to do this anymore. Our folks like doing it many times. Not all the time, but many times. And they'll do it over and over with very few errors. Okay. Assessment. So when we do assessment, we bring the candidates in, and we call them specialists. We bring them in and we take time to get to know them, what their strengths are, and then we're matching that up with the requirements or requests that we've had from clients. And the fact of the matter is that many of our specialists have graduated high school. A lot of them have graduated college. I got a call from a dad in New York. His son graduated from medical school in Chicago after getting a chemical engineering degree from Tufts University, magna cum laude, graduates from medical school, went 0 for 22 in his residency interviews. I said, well, how can that be? He said, well, when he gets stressed, and my son does this a lot too, when he gets stressed, he flaps his hands. And he said, you know, that's not a big deal when he's studying, but if he's a physician sitting in front of a patient and he gets stressed, that probably isn't going to work. And the fact of the matter is he was stressed when he was going through his interview process. Now, help me out. Do you think that that's a good use of his skills for a guy that can graduate from medical school to be unemployed? Because he's quirky? There's a lot of people in this community who have unbelievable skills, and they're quirky because they're on the spectrum. So they're not considered for the job, which is why we have MindShift. And folks that work with us at MindShift don't like it when I say this. I would love it if we went out of business, because that means that organizations have figured out how to recruit, assess, train, and place folks on the autism spectrum without our help. Isn't that a great idea? And we'll go do something else. We'll find something else to keep busy with. That's the ultimate goal. I mentioned support. We want to make sure that the interaction is successful for our clients and successful for our specialists. And that's why we really do lather on the support. Here's a quote from one of our clients, and I'll just be quiet so you guys can read it. It's pretty powerful.
You're assuming we can see it.
Right.
We're old back here.
That's great, because I was going to say the same thing. But do you want me to read it to you?
Yeah.
Okay. If I can see it. Our team is only as good as our people, and Darren is the best at what he does. His work product is timely, consistent, dependable, and he has low or no errors in his work. Many of the tasks that are well suited to his strengths are tasks that others on the team don't find engaging. So he provides a balance to the team. I have not experienced until we hired Darren. The process has been a positive one for our team. It has challenged how I think about hiring and how I staff my team. And at the end of the day, we're a much better team for having Darren here. She's with Accenture, and Accenture now is placing our specialists at their client locations at places like Best Buy and 3M, just to name a couple. And by the way, that's one of the things that I probably should talk about. I usually spend a lot of time talking about the autism advantage from a real dollars and cents perspective for our clients, but one of the things that we hear time and again from our clients is that by having this different person, this quirky person working there, interacting with them and learning to work with them, that the entire work environment is better. I love that. So we do good business. Again, we're not a charity, but we do good business, and we do it by doing good. And have you ever seen those things at like Spencer's Gifts or whatever, where you pick the ball up and hit it and there's five balls hanging from a string and then it clicks like this? I always think of that when I look at this. That wouldn't work because it's glass. So, but I'm reminded of that anyway. So MindShift, that's who we are and that's what we do. Thank you for this opportunity. Do you want me to repeat the question so it shows up on the tape? Question is, people on the autism spectrum who have these skills, are they ever going to be able to advocate for themselves and get a job on their own without support, right? Is that a good response? Hopefully. And there are very articulate people on the autism spectrum, so it's easy to generalize. If you talk to Temple Grandin, Temple Grandin's very articulate. Temple actually doesn't need a lot of support in advocating for Temple. She's very good at advocating. The reality is that it's not so much a matter of what the person on the spectrum is capable of. It's really what the mindset is of the employer. And the fact of the matter is that when we go in and meet with a client, an employer, we always make it very clear to them, this person is our employee. So if it doesn't work out in this task or this setting, we will place them somewhere else. We are invested in them. We want them to be successful. If this isn't a successful placement, we'll find another spot for them. That's actually a very comforting thing for folks who are first considering working with us, because if you think about it, it's probably a PR nightmare if you hire someone on the autism spectrum and it doesn't work out. What do? Fire them? That'll be on the Fargo forum probably, right? Is that what you want? Of course not. So when we take away that barrier, they're much more apt to try this. Once they've tried it, oftentimes they want to make our specialists their full-time employees. So to me, it's not a matter of the ability of the person with autism to advocate for themselves. It's really the willingness of an employer to look past maybe what they view as their shortcomings and concentrate on this skill set that has such great value. Does that make sense? Do you want to add to that?
Well, I would just add a little bit as we look at our adults who are dyslexic, even though they have gone through remediation, as far as applying for a job, our individuals are, you know, average to above average intelligence, and they can speak way better that they could probably answer a question on a piece of paper or type an email or fill out an application. So, you know, my thing is, really be attuned to, if you're sitting and interviewing that person and you think, oh my gosh, wow, this is the perfect person, or look at how articulate that person is, and then you look at that application and you say, oh my gosh, he can't spell, he's writing very poorly, this is not the person I need representing my business. They may just need a little bit of help or a little bit of guidance or some assistive technology tools to help them do that part. So just don't overlook those two different dynamics.
I want to add one more thing to that, and then I'll answer that question. If you look at, and if there's HR people here, go back and look at your job descriptions. Almost every job description I read, it'll list what the technical requirements are, and then it'll also say, great team player, great natural leader, great communicator. Those are generally not characteristics of folks on the autism spectrum because the social interaction is difficult. So when that boilerplate stuff, and with all due respect, I'll probably offend some people, that's laziness on the part of HR when that goes into every job description. We were talking to the folks at the chief diversity officer at 3M. They were all on board for this. They let us see some of their job descriptions after we signed a non-disclosure, because it's 3M, so everything's secret. And I read that to him. I said, now, the people that invent post-it notes, do you care if they're great communicators? And she said, no, we got a whole group of people. We just, they keep their door shut. We keep Mountain Dew and pizza stocked outside their door and leave them alone. I said, that's what we're talking about. Why is this in the job description? Right? Okay, I'm sorry. Question back there.
Get enough support from local level to national level, federal, you know, all over the country, and where we at comparing to other countries as far as support that is given to public. So comparing, let's say, Germany or spending high, or are we low?
I would say as far as dyslexia goes, the biggest part of our world that is addressing dyslexia in a good positive way is Australia. The United States still believes, and I go to national conferences every year, some of the United States still believe that dyslexia does not exist, that it's not a different learning disability, and we still call it the D word and won't say dyslexia out loud. So I would say Australia is really good. There's some places in the UK that are, but overall we're still trying to figure out what this thing is. And I say, you know, 1 in 5, and we look at autism, and he says, great, we are, you know, autism is out there now, which is awesome because we have an identification and we can start to learn and start to understand. Dyslexia is not there yet. I'm trying to change that, at least in our little community.
Our model is based on a Danish model for called Specialist Stern. If you're from Denmark, it's Specialistene. Mind Shift is easier to say than that, isn't it? Which is one of the reasons we rebranded. There are chapters or offices of this model in other countries, but depending on the country and depending on, like, socialist countries will tax higher, and then they will take some of that tax revenue to pay for salaries for people on the autism spectrum in the workforce. And we kind of view this as, because we have, and I know it sounds weird, I don't want to benefit from challenges necessarily, but the fact that the unemployment rate is so low and the fact that the skill sets that people with autism have are sought after, there's a business model that is can be successful and leveraged using this skill set. 5 or 10 years ago, when we were in the midst of the building, you know, no one was building anymore except maybe in Fargo. If the skill sets were being great at hanging drywall, then we don't have a business. But when it's things that relate to quality assurance, quality control, software testing, intricate production, then we have a great model. But depending on the country, some countries don't do anything for folks with autism. I think the United States has actually come a long, long way in the last 10 years.
I got a question for Carrie. I was paying attention, but I would like to know what you exactly do at Haley's Hope.
Thanks. I knew I was going to leave something out. So we, first of all, want to look at early intervention. So we do screenings, full evaluations, diagnostics of dyslexia. The main focus that we have is tutoring or coaching our kids with a structured literacy-based curriculum, which is Orton-Gillingham-based. It is the only research-based curriculum for dyslexia. So we use the Barton Reading and Spelling Method to teach our kids what those shapes and symbols are and what it means to create that shape or symbol or that letter on a piece of paper. So that's kind of our main focus, identification and remediation. We also do a lot of advocacy work. I do several presentations. I go into schools and colleges and teach the SPED departments. I've been at Concordia several years and work with families in their independent or individual education plans, or IEPs and 504s, and just really give power to the moms, help them become a bear for their children.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Alexandre Cusa. Thank you very much for broadening our awareness and informing us. I'm very grateful. So I had a question. I was privileged 2 years ago to intern at Freedom Resource Center, where they help people with disabilities to live more independent lives. And I remember during the Giving Hearts campaign, one of the things that struck me was this whole, when you think of the disabilities, the visible ones, you know, like, and I remember that's what was brought up, that there was those invisible ones that you don't see. And so me, I was just trying to see, as someone who always aspires to be inclusive and respectful and not offending someone without knowing, what are some of the very, you know, easy practices? Like, I love the way you said how sometimes I might have said it where, okay, everyone can read the brochures and just move on. Like, what are some simple, you know, practices that we could maybe take away as how to be very inclusive to the invisible disabilities?
I say for me, for my kids and my adults, it's asking them to write anything. You know, gosh, even my son, somebody will text him or send him a little email and he won't text back because he doesn't know how to spell the words he wants to say. And so some of his friends get mad and say, well, you never answer me. Or grandma, you never send me an email or you never write me a letter. It's very difficult for him to do that. So, though, yeah, you can't see it on them. And again, he has a conversation and a intelligence in his vocabulary that is beyond what I would ever imagine. But ask him to write something or pull something up on a phone is extremely difficult.
I would just say that because autism too, most people with autism look like everyone else. So I'll give you an example. We sit in the front row at church. Now, Lutherans never like to sit in the front row at church for some, I don't even know why that is, but that's pretty common. So it's usually open. But the reason that we started doing that years ago is because Joe will say stuff kind of at inappropriate times. And he is the first one to say amen at the end of every prayer at church, which some people are kind of put off by that, but we always figured if we talked to the pastor and he knew what was going on or she knew what was going on, then it was easier to explain it to that person than the 10 people that'd be sitting in front of us. So that's kind of how we handled it. But the fact of the matter is it's really a sensitivity. You know, when you see someone who's acting strange or quirky, by the way, that doesn't mean that they don't know what's going on. If you ask my son in the right setting, he will describe everything he saw in very graphic detail. And most people think he's completely unaware. So for me, it's really taught me a sensitivity that when I meet people or I see people, I can't automatically jump to the fact, well, that person must be drunk, or they must be on drugs or something, or psychotic, because they're saying something different or acting different. Maybe they're on the spectrum. I don't know. Courtney, did you want to say something?
Can I just add something to that?
Sure.
With autism, another thing that people will make an assumption that people who are on the spectrum are antisocial, that they don't, people assume that people on the spectrum are antisocial, that they don't want to socialize, that they don't want to be around people because socializing is very, very difficult for them. They don't make eye contact, but the truth of it is they don't understand the rules of socializing. And so because they don't make eye contact with you doesn't mean they don't want to talk to you. It doesn't mean they don't want to be accepted. It doesn't mean that they don't want to be a part of society, be invited to things. It's that they don't have the language that you have. And so that's a really big thing for my son. He says, I want to be invited to things. I want to play. I want kids to accept me, but they just assume I don't want to. And so understanding that antisocial and being uncomfortable in social situations are very different things. We all know people who are shy, who still want friends, but just don't know how to ask. And so that's just a big myth, I think, with people who are on the spectrum, that I think it's just good to know and understand that they do want to still be invited, they still want to be talked to and included and be a part of something for themselves.
I just want to add one of the things that, again, my son is profoundly dyslexic, and directionality is a big issue with our individuals with dyslexia. So part of that, when I went to the numbers, is telling time. If you ask somebody, if you were to say you were out and say, oh gosh, what time is it? I need to be somewhere at 2:45. And you ask them to tell you what time it is. So if you ask somebody what time, if you ask my son what time it was, he would just give you a number. He might say 27:15, because he doesn't get it. It's what time it is. A gal that works for me is also very dyslexic. Her husband bought her a really nice watch for one of their anniversaries. Really nice watch. She's like, oh, doesn't he know? So she didn't wear it for the longest time, and he said, okay, we're going out for dinner. Will you please wear that watch I gave you? She was like, darn it, okay. So she put the watch on. They went for dinner, and she's sitting there, and he's like, what time is it? She was like, she looked at her phone and said whatever it said on there, 2:47, whatever it said on there. And a little while later, he said, well, how did you know what time it was? Your watch is upside down. And she was like, darn it.
Yeah.
And she said, I told you, honey, I don't know what that means. It's an object. It's a piece of glitter on her arm. And to this day, when she wears it and it's backwards, we just love it. But it means nothing to her. But it's understanding that.
You know, it may be too late to get involved in this one, but how do you deal with the use of medication? You know, obviously you have behavioral problems. You could have, if you're dealing with parents of an autistic child or an autistic adult, where do you stand in terms of the use of medication? How do you interface with the medical system? You know, it's challenging. I've had a number of friends where they've really been challenged by whether to use medication that's been recommended by their pediatrician or by the school system or something, as opposed to behavioral modification kinds of things or behavioral strategies. So that's a, you know, a pretty challenging.
Yeah, I can't.
For parents and adults.
So the question was, how do we deal with medications and versus behavior modification, right? I will say that I was not in favor of medications for assisting our son. And after a period of time, our pediatrician and his psychiatrist finally convinced me that we should try it. And I will say that for our family, that has been an absolute miracle. And that doesn't mean that there haven't been some periods where we had to do some changes in dosage, et cetera, but in terms of dealing with anxiety for our son and in terms of interaction, it has been an absolute godsend. As it relates, that's just for our family, I can't speak for anyone else. As it relates to our specialists, we get to know our people. So if they are on a medication regimen, part of our support is encouraging them and making sure that they're taking their meds when they should. We don't prescribe, and we certainly don't monitor that other than to remind them to do that. But I would say that most of the folks that we know that are on the autism spectrum are taking some medication. Is that fair to say, Courtney?
Visualize things in ways that I cannot. He is spatially brilliant. And I think, would you say more about the advantages that dyslexia actually brings to people? Because I think too often we think about the limitations, and I think there are definite advantages.
Yeah, great, great advantages. One of the stats I really love is that NASA actively recruits individuals with dyslexia. Over 50% of their employees are dyslexic because of their great spatial reasoning abilities. So again, it might not look very good on paper, but as with, you know, our kids with autism, their mind is brilliant. We just need to figure out how to get that out of them. Athleticism is a great gift for some of our individuals with dyslexia. Just that, those other skills. My son takes apart things and puts them together, and I always worried when he was younger if all the parts were going to get back in the vacuum cleaner or whatever that was, and it actually worked better than Toolman Taylor when he would do it, Tim the Toolman Taylor. But he's constantly doing that. He's constantly creating a new way to close our freezer so it doesn't pop open and melt everything. He's constantly figuring out how to fix the lawnmower so that it does the edges better, or you know, re-figuring out how to do his bow. I mean, he's an avid bow hunter and He loves all of that. So his mind is thinking in different ways than mine ever would, all the time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carrie and Tim. You helped us to be reminded that it's about those uniquenesses and learning how to use those unique strengths that each person has. And thank you everyone for coming today, whether you came in the morning or you came for lunch. I hope you have been inspired and informed. And I hope to see you in September when we start all over again with the Lorentzsen Luncheons. Have a great summer. Thank you.